good evening and a very warm welcome to the Oxford Martin School. I'm Ian Golden, the director. It's a pleasure to see you all here. And it's a particular pleasure to welcome Connie Hedegaard. Connie was the first climate action commissioner for the European Union and has done many things for the first time. She was the youngest ever member of the Danish Parliament when she was elected. She was the youngest leader of various groups and has served, was the first energy and climate minister in Denmark as well. So she's a mold breaker. She knows better than anyone I know how to help us think about climate change negotiations. She was also the lead person in the run-up to the Copenhagen Climate Summit. She was the driver of that. Many of you will have heard of Copenhagen. Many of you may have views about Copenhagen. But the only person that really knows what happened there is Connie and the lead to it. So we are absolutely delighted that she's come to the Oxford Martin School today. She's had a day of meetings with many of our climate people from the physical and life sciences, but also from the social sciences and humanities, philosophy and other areas, helping us think about what we're doing, the relevance of what we're doing, and helping us to think about how we can be more effective in connecting what we're doing to the coming climate negotiations in Paris in December. She's also helped us think about our Safe Carbon Initiative, which is an initiative that we are trying to develop to think about how one might invest or disinvest in fossil fuels, what principles and what actions one may take along that. So Connie's been a tremendous source of inspiration for many people, is for us. I can think of no better person to be part of our climate change seminar series and to lead us in a conversation of this. Connie, we're delighted to have you here. The only good thing about you no longer being EU Climate Commissioner is that we can get you to come to Oxford. So thanks for finding the time, and please take the stage.
Thank you so much, Professor Ian Golden, for your much too kind introduction. It's great to be here. We have engaged over the years with different things, and it's great to be here in this at this place and also at the Oxford Martin School, actually to understand more of what you are doing. So thanks a lot for the invitation. It's a treat to be here. I'm not sure whether the headline I've been asked to talk over is a treat. You know, inside climate negotiations, a personal perspective. And there is some irony to that, because since I attended my first international climate conference back in 2004 as a Danish minister, I must say that I have hated these COPs. So it's sort of the irony of my life that I should sort of be one of those defending this process. Civil servants who have worked with me over these COPs will know that we are not many days or hours into a COP before I really get frustrated with the slowness of everything, all the spoilers who really do not want to sort of progress but want to stall progress, all these bad things you can say about the international process. Nonetheless, I'll try to make a case why, yes, it is difficult with the international climate negotiations, but it is worse without. And that I will hope I can convince you a bit about. And then I'll take care that I'm not doing all the talking. I understand we will have plenty of time also for a dialogue, and I really hope and look for, we'll be looking forward to that. But I'll try and elaborate a bit on why. What are some of the mechanisms that are working in international climate discussions as I have seen them? But before we get to that, I have a small sort of movie I would like to show to you, just to know what we are talking about. I also have a background in journalism, and in journalism we say, don't tell it, show it. So what I wanted to show you here is, it's not fiction. It's not a prognosis, it's not an estimate, it is simply how temperatures worldwide have been registered on different measuring stations around the planet since 1880. Where it is bluish and whitish, it gets colder. Where it's sort of golden, orange, and red, it gets warmer. And you can see there is not much to report about. It is sort of getting colder, it's getting warmer. Not much news in that. But then try and watch. So that was just to sort of say, that's sort of the very short story. That is how an average temperature increase globally of 0.8 degrees Celsius looks like. And you could also say, it's no wonder when you watch this sort of collection of data, it's done by a Norwegian member of the IPCC, Helge Drangen. It will come as no surprise as 2014 was the hottest year ever registered. This shows very clearly. 9 out of 10 of the hottest years ever registered globally have been registered in this young century. And for now 38 years in a row, we have had an average global temperature that surpasses that of the average global temperature for the 20th century. In other words, a bit more like a trend, I would say. But then at the same time as we have this challenge, as you will know, we have another challenge in the population growth. And I normally call this the double challenge, because even if we did not have this climate movie running, we would still have a tremendous challenge in how to accommodate a still growing world population with the needs we have, with heating and cooling and food and energy and what have we, modern commodities. So that's what I call the global challenge that I think combined puts the question in front of us. Whether we like it or not, we will get growth, we will have to have growth, an enormous amount of growth we will get, but the key question is, how will we create that growth? Which kind of growth? So that is sort of the double challenge. And also, it's not just a question of economic growth, it's a question of prosperity and well-being in general. In the security establishment, they already, for some years, have been talking about climate change as a threat multiplier. It's not climate change that can, of course, explain all sorts of crises around the planet, but it is a threat multiplier making other kind of challenges even worse. You could take Horn of Africa, you could take Mali, you could take Pakistan, you could take the Philippines, the list is getting longer and longer. Climate change is a threat multiplier. I'm not going to bore you with a lot of these sort of climate statistics, I'll come to the negotiations, but this is basically why whatever we can agree to do matters. I would just provide you with one recent example. A study from Columbia University came out last month mentioning Syria. We all know that there's been a civil war in Syria going on, but there they sort of linked that to climate change. How could they do that? Because they argued that from 2007 to 2010, they had the most severe drought in Syria. It became so severe that 1.5 million Syrians moved from the rural areas into the cities, which of course could not, in such a short span of time, absorb 1.5 million new inhabitants. We all know that in Syria they have other problems, problems with immigrants from the Iraq war, problems with the authoritarian Assad regime, many other challenges. But climate change, the drought linked to climate change, was sort of a threat multiplier. And these researchers from Columbia and some other universities sort of made the point that we should be aware it's not something distant we are talking about. Climate change as a threat multiplier is already a reality. So obviously, in my mind, what we really are talking about when we are talking about how to address climate change is basically the question, how can we transform our economies into much more sustainable economies, into another kind of growth model, basically. It goes without saying that you do not change our current development model, our current economic growth model, only through climate negotiations only through the UNFCCC. The climate convention was adopted back in 1992. We had the Kyoto Protocol, and that whole setup agreed in 1997, you know, of all the challenges of getting it ratified when the US, even during Gore, Clinton administration, could not sort of send it to Congress because they knew that it would be defeated. They stayed out of it, but the Kyoto Protocol entered formally into force February 2005, after Russia had ratified it. You also know the thinking behind this whole Kyoto setup. The thinking being, we have a global challenge. We need to give a global response. Thus, we should try and create a global framework around how to address climate change. There's a certain logic to that, I think. It fits into a pattern where we know that we are having more and more globalized markets, more and more globalized trade, more and more globalized competition, more and more globalized financial institutions, investment environments, what have we. But our political global institutions are very weak. Global governance is very weak. To do global, to do politics, take democratic decisions at the global scale is incredibly difficult. And that is, of course, what we have felt in the climate negotiations. Likewise, the combined political ability to agree on international policies, I mean, it's not just a question or a challenge in the climate field. You could take the Arab Spring, you could take the Russian-Ukraine crisis, you could take many other issues, and we would come more or less to the same conclusions that the global political institutions, the ability to take decisions at an international scale is rather limited, or at least too limited to sort of cope with the challenges. Of course, in the climate field, the opposition from the US for very many years played a significant role, I would argue, in slowing down and stalling international negotiations. Then in 2007, international, we adopted what was called the Bali Roadmap, meaning the world should, by Copenhagen 2009, should agree an overall framework for how to cope with climate change. And just for the record, it was not just something that a handful of Europeans made up or some Danes made up. The whole world, if you go back and sort of see what came out of different G20 meetings and Commonwealth meetings and what have we meetings in the run-up to Copenhagen 2009, all of them would say, now we are going to do it, and we all know that they were not going to do it. Of course, what was sort of the thinking at that time was we would have to try to listen so much to science that the politicians would actually do what adds up to what the science told politicians would be necessary. And thus, we had this top-down approach. But with, for instance, the US, not really, but not only the US, but among the big emitters, US, not wanting to play ball, what we saw was what I call this after-user syndrome. The Chinese saying, we are not doing it. We are a poor developing country. We're an emerging economy. The industrialized countries must go first. And of course, the Chinese would say, as long as the Americans are not moving, why should they be moving? On the other hand, some strong forces in the United States said that we will not be moving as long as the Chinese are not moving. And for many years, sort of the international negotiations were sort of marred by this after-user syndrome. However, in 2009, due to the fact that 119 heads of states and prime ministers came to Copenhagen, actually the world community somehow adopted the 2 degrees. As sort of the overall bar we should stay below. In the run-up to Copenhagen and after Copenhagen, more than 90 states made their own climate policies. That was not the case before that. Today, more than 60 countries have specific climate legislation. There were sort of monitor MRV policies, how to monitor, report, and verify whatever is being done. There was a forestry regime. many other sort of partial elements. So it's not that the international negotiations have not moved forward at the different COPs. Every time you have seen some kind of steps forward. But I would argue that some of the things that we are still struggling with internationally, also now prior to the next international conference, which will take place in Paris later this year, will be some familiar elements that we have been struggling with for quite a bit. Take, for instance, this issue about legally binding. We all know that there we have different traditions in the world we are living in. In the EU, in the European Union, we have normally no problems with international treaties or deals being legally binding. And that's a tradition. It could, for instance, also, you could just take it as an example, the International Court of Justice. Europe has no problem with that. The Americans would have problems with that. The Chinese would have problems with that, not wanting to sort of commit in a binding way internationally. Doesn't necessarily mean they will not commit, but not in a binding way. I think it's also due to the whole way the European Union is constructed that in Europe, we don't mind things being binding. Why? Because if we are going to agree anything in Europe, we know that we better do it binding, some way or the other. That's the way we work in the European Union. Take the 2020 targets that was adopted a few years before Copenhagen in order to be ready for Copenhagen. Yeah, it was binding targets for CO2 emissions, for renewables, for energy efficiency, with governance structure, individual targets for countries, and so on and so forth. I know from my past as a minister, when I had to fight, as every climate or environment minister will have to do with the finance ministry, it means something that you can say, listen, we have signed up to these binding targets at the EU level. So it comes with quite a political price if you are not sort of living up to it. So that is our tradition. Empirically, we know in Europe that it works and it enhances sort of the mutual trust if you know that the others are also delivering. But this legally binding question, that is still one of the big issues for Paris. And there is no doubt that when it comes to the core, the contributions, the specific actions, then to the very last moment, this will still be a debate, binding or not binding. Political intention, is that the best we can get? Would it be binding? I'll come back to this, but it's one of the areas where things have to move and positions have to move if something substantial is going to come out of Paris. The other thing is transparency. Seen from a European perspective, transparency is a no-brainer. Of course, if you are engaging internationally, you need to create transparency. But it's not a no-brainer to a Chinese. In China, statistics are still not sort of that much published, to put it that way. Even what is business as usual? It is a state secret. What is business as usual? It's not as transparent as it is in our tradition. So transparency, if we can change things there, that will also be a game changer, also for a political reason. Because if all the parties around will accept more transparency, it's also a way of saying we accept that what we do in my country matters to the rest of the world. That is also a different approach, saying we do what we do and it's none of your business, saying here it is, transparent, we understand why what I do is of relevance to you and vice versa. So transparency is one of the key issues that have also been really challenging for these many years and will still be up to Paris. And of course, the last one I would mention is sort of what we in the lingo of negotiators and negotiations would call the firewall. In the Kyoto Protocol, it was established that the developed countries, those who were developed back in the 90s when the climate convention was agreed, they should be obliged to do something, they should have commitments, whereas those who were developing countries, G77 plus China, they should only come up with things voluntarily, on a voluntary basis. So you could say what we have been struggling with in the climate negotiations is basically the whole old paradigm of North-South. So we are trying through the climate negotiations to move from the old North-South paradigm to a new paradigm where we base multinational agreements on a paradigm of interdependency. That's a different kind of world, and that's, of course, what is at stake, and that's why it's so difficult to agree in this partial, this sort of sectoral issue like climate change, as some would like to see it, and then basically it's about the whole way the UN system works. Of course, when it comes to the firewall, EU and US would be allies, and Japan and Russia and Australia and Canada and what have we, all the OECD countries, all the Annex I countries basically, would agree that the new reality is that we are living in a more interdependent world and that this problem cannot be solved without some of the emerging economies taking their fair share of the responsibility. But this is, for reasons I mentioned before, this is one area where China has said US should go first. Now US is moving, the Obama administration is moving, and that is part of why the dynamic is also changing. Let me put in one thing here. Prior to Copenhagen, 2009, China took the initiative to form the basic group. China, India, Brazil, and South Africa. The four emerging economies sort of being one group. I have seen at recent climate COPs that they almost negotiate as a group. My personal view is that was a strange thing for India to engage in. It was clearly in China's interest. Why is that? Because China today accounts for around one-fourth of the global emissions. The US for around 15%, EU for around 10%. But remember, there are 200 million more Americans than there are people living in the European Union. Even per capita, it seems this year China will be surpassing the per capita emission to that of Europe, but the US will still emit roughly 2 to 2.5 times as much per capita as will China and the European Union. But India, they are down to less than 2 tons per capita. China and the EU is about 7. In my view, nobody would or should ask the same of India as they should be asking of China. And I think that by creating this basic, it was really not to the favor of India because they were too much put in the basket together with the Chinese. I think this should be one of the areas where things should be softening up a bit. We should start to sort of treat India very much separate from how China is treated. Let me give you two examples when you have asked me to say something about inside climate negotiations. Two concrete examples, how this works, or doesn't work, but you can judge. Take Durban. 2 years after Copenhagen, there was this climate summit in South Africa, in Durban. Europe had learned a tough lesson in Copenhagen. You remember when Obama came to see the Chinese premier, Wen Jiabao, at that time. Obama went into the room, and he saw that there sat Lula from Brazil, and Zuma from South Africa, and they sat there, and from India, the Indian prime minister same. And Obama said, should we call Europe? And what was the answer? No, there's no need to call Europe. I tell you that for the European leaders around there, that was something they really sort of felt. Wow, could they sit in that room and Europe not be part of it? You know, Merkel was there, Brown was there from this country, Barroso from the Commission. That really was something to note. So my first priority, being the Commissioner right after Copenhagen, being the EU Commissioner, that was to try to get Europe speak with one voice. And now I know I'm in Britain, so one should be careful what you say about what this means. It does not mean that only one can do the talking, but it means that the European strategy is clear, that whatever messages come out of European ministers and commissioners and what have we will be coordinated and on the same, at the same page. So that was what we really tried to do, and then we reached out to, I would say in the end, it turned out to be around 100 developing countries to try to make the right allies. It's clear that when you have big emerging economies saying, we do not want to, we cannot do, we are a developing country, we cannot make climate strategies, we cannot commit to anything. And then you have poor, low-lying island states or least developed countries in Africa or elsewhere saying, but we are doing it. We are taking on this target, we are doing this, we are doing that. Then it was much more challenging for instance, China to keep their line of arguing. So we made these alliances with more than 100 countries because our main priority 2 years after Copenhagen was to remove this old firewall. The world cannot address climate change by only a handful of countries actually doing their fair bit. Just for clarity, nobody would argue that China would have to do the same as the US or India would have to do the same as Europe. We would, of course, still work with these common but differentiated responsibilities. More rich countries, more industrialized countries would, of course, have to do more earlier. You know, these COPs, they take 2 weeks. Ministers will arrive in for week two. And then there is this thing with these climate COPs. It has to be so transparent. You know, in Copenhagen, there were days where there were 40,000 people. And when we asked the UNFCCC secretary, the climate secretary, can we cut down on that? No, 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 because that would be undemocratic. Everyone who wants to come should be able to come. So this is a tool that can often be used, that everything has to take place in big, big plenaries. We will all know, how on earth would you negotiate things like this in big, big plenaries? It's simply not possible. So you would always have friends of the chair or something else, but in Durban, we did something different. We were actually for days and days and days and nights, 20, 25 persons in a back room, a bit away from sort of where most of the things were happening, really discussing how can we move this process forward. That was dangerous in a way, because you could be accused that that was really sort of not the way, the spirit where everybody has to be included. But we had hours and hours and hours of talk with the Americans, the Europeans, the Chinese, the Indians, what have you. One of the problems with the UNFCCC is that it's excellent to create awareness. It's an excellent process to mobilize people, this at least once a year, but it is impossible to negotiate real deals on the spot. It's also clear that this transparency tool will often be used by what I call the spoilers, those who are not at all interested in any progress. Every time it seems that progress can be made, they can just claim this was very untransparent. So there is a very sort of evil dynamic now and then in all this, and it's easy to sour the atmosphere. In Durban, we really fought over many things, but primarily two things in this room. When should the deadline be for a new climate agreement? The Americans argued it should be 2017. It was not that difficult for an American Obama administration to set 2017 as the deadline, because they would be out of office. That was the only thing for sure. That was, of course, also why we insisted it had to be earlier, and that's why it now says at the latest in 2015, and surprise, we did not do it before. It will be hopefully in Paris. So the timing was one of the issues. And the big obstacle was this: everyone should be part of it. That was the biggest challenge. There is one thing about this, I'm talking about this being inside the negotiations. In international politics, it can be extremely rude, but in a way, in an odd way, it's also sometimes extremely polite. You know, you do not name and shame anybody. You do definitely not point your finger at somebody specific. That's just not how you're doing sort of diplomacy. But what we actually did in Durban was at some point first push the Brazilians and the South African host a lot. So on Tuesday, I think it was, Brazil announced that they were going away from the basic position. They would sort of accept that they should be part of it. And the day after, the South African host did the same. So on Friday in the second week, Friday is the day where it's supposed to end, the negotiations. It's also the day where I have never seen it end on this Friday. But it's supposed to end there. And I had this press conference at 10 and said, now we are only waiting for three more countries. China and India, that is half of BASIC, and the United States. And that was sort of, that's not the way normally to sort of do it, because you don't mention them by name. But that, of course, maximized the pressure. So to cut a long story short, I really think that in these days, we had the real, real tough battle over. In the 21st century, when doing international deals on how to deal with international challenges, common challenges, are we all in this, or will only some of us be obliged to do something? That was the big thing. And it ended, you know, Saturday morning, Saturday day, Saturday afternoon, Saturday night, Sunday morning, and then at some point it ended. And it was really some very challenging plenaries where in the end the Indian minister who fought to the last for not sort of being part of this had to give in. Underlining my point on the basic and the solidarity among the emerging economies, what happened and during that plenary, she had, the Indian minister, she had to fought this alone. The Chinese were sitting on their seat, staring straight out, not asking for the floor once. So there, I think the Indians learned the hard way that there's a limit to how much solidarity they could expect from there. But then we end up, after a lot of sort of things, with this sentence, a protocol that we should be working towards, a protocol, another legal instrument, or an agreed outcome with legal force applicable to all parties. I don't blame you for not understanding what I'm saying. People have been struggling ever since to find out what these words mean. But the important thing was applicable to all parties, and something about legal, but not exactly saying what it is that should be legal. Now, I'm not going to bore you with all the details of international negotiations, but just to say that as much as you can sort of say, oh, that's strange, I have also learned during these 10 COPs what it means. When you actually get these words into a UN document, it sets the direction for the following years and negotiations. And to this day, up to now to Paris, this will be the sentence. That is the reason why I would argue there still is a process and that there is a deadline and that some expectations will be out there for what Paris can deliver. Let me be very clear. I'm not obviously arguing that if only we have such an international agreement with some of these obstacles solved, then everything is solved. No, of course not. It sets the bar. After that comes all the action. But it sets the bar. And why is that important? I think it's very important in a global world with global competition to make nations do more than they would do without that bar. I mean, I have seen that in Danish politics and European politics. You can always argue, well, why should I do this if my competitors are not doing it? So what we're trying to establish through the international negotiations will be that we can feel confident to go to the maximum of what we can do and in a cost-efficient manner and all this, knowing that our competitors, they are not totally off the hook. I think that that is where the international negotiations really matters. It's clear that if you ask US and China, they would, from the outset, very much have wanted a bottom-up approach, We do what we do, you do what you do, and we see what it adds up to. In Europe, we know today that if you want a total top-down approach, you will not get enough countries on board. But on the other hand, we also know if you're only in a total bottom-up regime, you will not have enough action done to stay below the 2 degrees that leaders pledged in Copenhagen, that they would sort of keep the world below. So that means Paris has to be a hybrid between some top-down elements and some bottom-up action. What is then the success criteria for Paris? Well, the added value of an international deal, as far as I can see it, must be more than we would just have had through a pure bottom-up thing. If I'm confident you're doing your job, I'm doing mine, then I dare do a bit more. That must be the essence. So I think if Paris cannot give a good answer to, yes, there is added value in an international process, then of course the counter question would be, why then bother with all these international talks? So I think that's the biggest challenge for Paris, and I think that it's very, very essential that when before Paris ends that we can see that there is added value in doing this overall framework together, and that it is likely also after Paris that the world still has a chance to stay below the 2 degrees. You will not get the total recipe in Paris for how that should be done, but it must be likely, the door must not be closed to the 2 degrees. I think that's a fair success criteria. But it goes without saying that the pledges, the contributions, it must not be called commitments anymore because that signals something binding. So the contributions, of course, in the end consist of what cities and regions and business and sectors and what have we are doing. I know that there are some in business saying, let's get rid of this international process. We are running much ahead of the politicians. So that I will say with the experience I've had, yes, a few are. The front runners, yes, they would do it. But I can tell you that the bulk of business, they do not move in this area unless there is some politics that actually forces them to do so, be it targets or pricing or regulation or best a bit of it all. But it does not come automatically. And I think there is a paradox in many of these business people telling us, oh, you should just let us do it ourselves, while they then are leaning back and wait until there is a fantastic international deal that they can sort of say, okay, now we know what the playing field will be. I've seen this also, and that's my second and last example, on EU 2030, because that has something to do with international climate politics also. I mean, we have seen in Europe, it works when you put up targets. It works. During the crisis, you would not have expanded in renewables in Britain had it not been for some binding targets. I really don't believe it. I know from my own country, Denmark, it means something if you can be name and shame for not delivering on this. If some NGOs will start shouting of your government saying, now you've got other priorities, what about this? You have this binding EU target. It means something. So I think that was also why we thought it would be crucial for the whole Paris situation that Europe had made its homework well in advance, presenting what we would do after 2020. It's of course also to do with Europe's self-perception. We have some soft power in this area. A lot of developing countries will look to Europe for leadership here. Sorry to say, but that's not happening in so many other fields in international politics. So it's one of the areas where Europe still has some soft power. That means that we should also lead by example. So therefore, at COP19 in Warsaw, 1.5 years ago, a deadline was set. We wanted that the new pledges that should be for Paris should be known well in advance, so that when we know what each other will be doing, that then we could have a process to say, will that close the gap? That, of course, was something where we can contribute to the international talks, but it also works the other way around. I could, and I will spare you for that now, but I could write a whole book about how many buttons you have to push in Europe to get 2030 targets adopted. And how you also internally in the European discussion, in order to secure some ambition, can use the international process. Just to take one example, Ban Ki-moon's climate summit in New York last year that convened 125 heads of state in New York. We suggested to him, fall of 2012, why not repeat, we did that before Copenhagen, why not repeat that in September 14 in New York? And he took on the idea, and when he presented it, President Barroso and other good forces tweeted immediately, we will come. What had that to do with 2030? Had a lot to do with 2030, because we knew that if we were going to put pressure on our leaders in Europe in order to sort of get their act together on the targets, it would help if there was an international deadline where the leaders would like to come to New York and tell about all the brilliant things we are doing in Europe. Just one example, but there are many examples of how this is playing together. And that, of course, also, and when we then get our act together, the 2030 targets, 40% domestic emissions reduction in Europe by 2030 compared to 1990, efficiency targets, renewables target, when that was adopted 23rd of October last year, I know from a minister who was with the Chinese minister that the very day that decision was up at the European Council, the Chinese told this minister, you're never going to agree on that. Europe actually, in the midst of a crisis, managed to agree on that. And what happened 3 weeks later? We had President Obama and President Xi Jinping coming out from a G2 meeting and for the first time ever announcing respectively what they are doing. And we can discuss endlessly whether that was ambitious or not, but the really interesting stuff there was that for the first time ever, China came forward in front of the whole world and saying, when we peak our emissions, is somebody else's business. And that was the real gain there. Just before I come to sort of my conclusion, I would just say, of course, when Europe is defining its 2030 targets, it's not just about international negotiations. You have to make the very strong economic case ourselves. It was not in that light, don't get me wrong, but in that light it was not bad that the first time our leaders in Europe had to discuss the 2030 targets, that was in March last year. What happened March last year? That was the Crimea, the Ukrainian crisis, the Russian crisis. So some of the Eastern member states who might not be too keen on setting new climate targets, they were definitely very, very keen in discussing, for instance, energy independency and energy efficiency, things like that. It is telling, isn't it, that some of the least energy efficient member states we have in the European Union, they are the most dependent on Russian gas. You can speculate yourself how that come, but there is probably a good economic reason for that. Ask Bulgaria. Every time they try to do reforms in the energy field, the Russians will just lower the gas cost, and thus it's very difficult to get things through politically. But there was this knowledge and really strong feeling we must prioritize energy dependency, energy become less energy dependent. During the crisis year 2012 and 2013, each year Europe spent net 400 billion euros to pay for our imported fossil fuels bill, oil, coal, and gas. Around one third of that ended up in Russia, somehow in Putin's system. Let me come to the final part of what I want to say. Yes, this climate show is slow. But yes, it makes a difference. UNFCCC is and can only be a part of climate change policies. It's the framework. To fill out this frame, it takes a lot more politics. I mentioned EU, how we're doing it with targets, regulations, standards. I think that one of the key obstacles we are faced with, our key challenges right now, is to get climate change into the mainstream of economic policies, growth policies, development policies. In other words, it has to be taken away from climate and environment ministers only. And it puzzles me, and I've had the chance earlier today to discuss with some of you present here, but it still puzzles me how come that the World Bank, the IMF, the International Energy Agency, the OECD, all sort of key financial institutions in this world would say you have to get serious about incorporating low carbon development strategies into the core of your economic thinking, and then it's still not happening with scale and speed in, for instance, finance ministries. Another thing we need is fossil fuel subsidies reform. Everybody would agree it's crazy to continue to subsidize fossil fuels. We all know there are social implications. It's very important how you're phasing it out. But I also think that most people can see that when prices in the oil market is going down, that is the moment where you can make a reform of fossil fuel subsidies. Of course not when prices are going up. I think that what we need is a total sort of a consistent policy with pricing externalities. In the field of climate, some progress is being done there. Last year at Ban Ki-moon's climate summit, there was this declaration on pricing carbon and a demand for having a global price on carbon. You know what? More than 70 countries signed up to that, among them China. Not the US, unfortunately, Congress preventing it, but China did. And China's right now experimenting with 7 pilot schemes on pricing carbon. They call it pilot schemes. It's for 250 million people. It's a relatively big pilot scheme, I would say. But the expectation is that by next spring, when they present their next 5-year plan, we will get the year where they expect to have a national carbon price. That is really interesting. And then just very briefly, I think that there are also new paradigms to observe. And I'll come back to why that is should be some of your business. New paradigm on recycling, reuse, new consumption patterns instead of just buy and buy and throw out and consume. I think this sharing paradigm is interesting. I think there are some new undercurrents that are interesting for how we think our economy. I know that this is tough, also because of the crisis. How to start such a transition? One of the things that I have observed is a big obstacle here. That is the fact that we are organized in our societies in silos, in sectors. And actually that goes for politics, goes for administrations, it goes for cities. But many of the challenges we are faced with are cross-cutting. So that is also a challenge to the academic society. How to think more cross-cutting and multidisciplinary? It's absolutely key, and it's absolutely key for the politicians to get this more interdisciplinary approach visible. I know that you have certain obligations as researchers, as academia. And I know that what I'm now going to ask you is somehow maybe not fair. But I have to say that what I have seen is a need seen from a policymaker's perspective, we need science and academia to communicate better. To communicate better the knowledge, the insight, the solutions that you have, and to get that insight to the politicians timely. And that's a huge challenge, because academia is thinking for the sort of longer term and in-depth and working in sequences of years. How to put it, that's not always the way politics is working. Nonetheless, it's extremely important to get the timely input. I would say that often decision makers take maybe strange decisions, but it's not out of bad will. Sometimes it's simply because all the knowledge that is out there is not in front of them when they need it, when they take the decisions. So that is something I think for the academia to consider how to be better there. Take just an example and then I'll finish. We have a divest discussion coming up. I know it's also something that is being discussed at this university, it's discussed at many universities, pension funds, whatever. But we need, in order to sort of not just have that as a symbolic thing, we need more profound knowledge. What are the implications if we're doing this or if we're doing that? What are the long-term sort of implications? And I know that good people here also working on providing that. It goes without saying, in the world we live in order to sort of have the business solutions or the habits changing or whatever, we need to have cost-efficient solutions, and it needs to be known out there what kind of solutions there is to choose from. So timing in communicating is extremely important. Let me finish then with just one more on this timing, because there I end where I started with the international talks. I know that some of you, you're very aware that Paris is coming up. Many NGOs will be very much aware of that. We'll meet in Paris. Then we'll be marching in the streets or what? But again, timing is essential. It's not in Paris that the Paris decisions will be taken. I'm putting it a bit too black-white. But the mandates for governments, they are being prepared now. And they will be ready by the latest September, very latest October. So it's also if those who want to influence these kind of processes, they have really to understand the timing in these processes and try to sort of activate citizens, put the pressure from beneath while time is still there. Governments very rarely change their positions in front of thousands of participants in a COP or in front of running cameras. I believe that we will have a deal in Paris. Maybe not a big surprise for you. I think the big question is what kind of deal? I sometimes feel, I do not know if you know this Danish movie, the Celebration, it's called. With this young man making a speech for his father's anniversary, and he makes the father choose among two different speeches, the nice and conventional one, and then the terrible one, revealing all the secrets of the family. Sometimes when speaking about these climate issues, I feel like I could make both speeches. About everything that is going too slow and too much backtracking and what have we. And then, and that is where I will end, I can also make the more positive speech. EU managed in the midst of a crisis to get quite ambitious targets through for 2030. Despite of their shale gas findings in the US, they are moving more in renewables and efficiency and what have we, car standards than ever. China has given up this notion of grow first, clean up later. They have understood that that is threatening their social stability in China if they are not getting their pollution on track. In India, Modi is understanding if 400 million Indians are going to be connected to some kind of electricity in his term, he better use more renewables and more efficiency. And last month, Bloomberg New Energy Finance could tell the world that in 2013, the world hit the turning point. From 2013, continuing into 2014, the world was installing more renewable new energy capacity than fossil fuel energy capacity. And by the way, I started showing this movie to you, but in 2014, actually, emissions stabilized for the first time in, ever. Despite the fact that we had a global growth of 3.7% in the global GDP. So, do these climate change conferences and the international politics around it, does it matter? I think it does. I tell you, if it looks messy from the outside, it looks absolutely no better from the inside. If it looks slow and frustrating from the outside, don't believe it's better from the inside. But would the world have been better suited to address climate change and to slow down that accelerating movie without the international climate negotiations, without EU's combined efforts? I hope I have given you the contours of what my answer would be. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Connie, for what was a really inspiring talk. I didn't mention that one of Connie's previous experiences was being the news anchor and head of radio news in Denmark for a long period of time. Your communication skills are absolutely superb, but so too is your clarity of vision, the strategic insights you bring, and of course your ability to balance what is absolutely necessary, which is the real pessimism at times of the experience, but also the optimism and absolute necessity of the will of for the outcomes. So thank you. I think we were hugely enriched by that. Connie, incidentally, is also epitomizes the interdisciplinarity that she told us about, because she has a master's degree in English literature and history, and is now a globally renowned, not only politician, but knowledgeable person on climate change. So we try and emulate that here as well. We've got about 35 minutes for questions and answers. Please identify yourselves. This is being webcast and recorded, so if you don't want to be webcast and recorded, I suggest you don't put your hands up. Who'd like to go first?
There's
a roving mic here.
Great, thanks very much. My name's Camilla Tullman. I'm director of IIID. We've had the pleasure of working with you, Connie, in many different shapes and forms, particularly giving voice to the least developed countries, which, as you rightly say, is a hugely important part of breaking up this completely false dichotomy between North and South, and where we need to move into a very different way of understanding how power is exercised. I think my question really relates on us having moved from the science through the economics to the politics, where right now it seems to me looking at powerful interests that do not want the kind of agreement that we urgently need to have. I wondered what your view was, what your vision is of where Saudi Arabia can turn now, or what would you say to some of the new emerging African oil and gas producers who suddenly have fallen upon potential riches and are being told, keep it in the ground?
Saudi Arabia. Yeah, now I said that sometimes I'm doing naming and shaming, but I didn't mention them when I was talking about the spoilers, but some in the room will know that they have a long reputation of not being the most constructive in the international climate talks. But I see that partly changing. And I think that is, if one visits Saudi Arabia, for instance, they know that they have to diversify their economy. They are actually setting up targets for solar. They have some of the best solar laboratories, I understand, in the world, and they have sort of money to finance it, and they are bringing in researchers from around the world. So it's getting a bit more mixed. And I think that very deliberately, they changed sort of negotiators a year ago or something like that. So at least they try to. Maybe they're just doing it different, but I think that they are trying to play a different role. And I think there are some good people also in some of the United Arab Emirates, some of these countries, they understand that they need to diversify. And this is going to hurt them. If you looked at that movie, sort of where is it that it's really getting hot and dry? It's in part of their area, and the water problems are adding on. So it's just to say that the fronts are not as clear as they were. It's clear if you're a Nigerian, you're living from oil, it's not that sort of obvious what to do about this. There I think the African Union should play quite a should play a role there. South Africa has a leadership role there. So it's very important how the African Union, normally before a COP and definitely before Paris, they will meet all the environment ministers. They will also meet at heads of states level. And I know the French will be working very, very targeted on the African position. Because I do not see Nigeria or the oil nations as spoilers. They sort of have an open mind to it. And I think that many countries start to realize that diversification is not that dangerous. To others, some of the least developed countries, the low-lying island states, there it means something. They understand we would like to skip import diesel and instead install solar or wind or whatever, but then you have to help us pay the incremental cost. I mean there is a trade-off there with the financing part of the deal, as you will be very much familiar with.
So Crispin.
Crispin Tickell. I just wanted to follow up a point you made during your very interesting speech, and that is how science should be presented in order to persuade. I think that one of the great penalties of the past has been that the scientific community hasn't really shown both the penalties of not doing things and the benefits of doing them. And there's an interesting piece in this, in I think last week's edition of Science magazine, in which they chide the scientific community for their failure to cope with this. So I think that when the scientific community presents its case, it must really be able to show what will happen if you don't succeed and what you could achieve if you get it right. And I think that's a point that I'd just like to add to your points that you made eloquently in your speech.
Yeah, very briefly, I would agree with that. And that is something that we have problems in grasping in the way we, for instance, make budgets. You know, you can see what it costs to do something, or if you spend 1 billion on this, but if you don't, it's as if it comes for free. It's how are we assessing the cost of inaction? Of course, Lord Nick Stern sort of made that point many years ago, but I still think it's extremely important to have these counter pictures to say, you think that if you continue business as usual, your business as usual is what you get. But if you continue business as usual, the only thing that is for sure is that you do not get business as usual. And to try to value that and assess that in economic terms. I'm not an economist, as you heard. I can understand why this is difficult. But that's the kind of things we need to work more with, like co-benefits. Also, we are not very good at assessing co-benefits. Had many battles in the Commission. If you are reducing a number of health implications or whatever, what is that worth? How to assess that? And that is one area where I would sort of need more input from the science community. I would say on the natural sciences, a strong case has been made. More needs to be done on the economic case and also on the social sciences, on human behavior and that aspect and how to change people's mind, how to get more long-term thinking into a short-term policy domain. How do you do that? We need the input more articulated, maybe more visible from other sides of science than the natural sciences.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Benito Müller. I have a procedural question, a question of how to improve the UN process. But first, I thought I'd share a little, what I think, rather amusing anecdote about the parentage of BASIC. Because an insider told me that the father of BASIC was actually J. Ram Ramesh, the Indian environment minister, but the godfather was Tony Blair. Now, you may wonder why. Well, this was G8 plus G5, Glen Eagles. When G5 was BASIC plus Mexico, and Mexico was always going to be out, and the others felt singled out. Right, and the first time singled out as a group, and then in their infinite wisdom, they formed a group. And India in particular saw it as a shield. They needed China as a shield, which then obviously, as you said, very nicely sidestepped in Durban, but so did the Americans, by the way. I mean, in the end, you and Jayanti was left out there. Now the question is, with your experience from Copenhagen, clearly people will make comparisons process-wise between Copenhagen and Paris. What would be your advice to to the people in Paris of what not to do and what definitely to do. In particular, would you re-invite heads of state? Thank you.
They invited.
Very, very, very simple question. Just first for the history, I have discussed this with Ramesh. And Ramesh openly said, yeah, but you know, there was this idea floating around, and the Chinese sort of, and we thought for domestic reasons in India that we had to have at least one area where it looked as if India and China could work together. So that was sort of the domestic reason why. But Ramesh would, I'm very sure, I mean, he would today acknowledge that it did not serve India's interest very well. It was for another purpose about domestic politics. Would I invite heads of states? Well, no, I'm not having to make that choice, but I would say that that has been done. They have, and there was the climate summit last year also. The problematic thing, and you will know, because you know this process, is also something we discussed very much internally in Denmark at the point. It's very good to mobilize, to get it to the top of the head of prime ministers that they know that they are going themselves. But it's also clear with such a UN process, the moment you announce that the leaders are arriving, say, Thursday, how will environment ministers move from their known positions Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday? I mean, that's, so it depends very much. If you have sort of the contours of an agreement, if you have the key groups saying, yes, we are ready, and you know that they are delivering, then you can, of course, call in heads of states to sort of sign off and applause. But you better be sure that there's something to applaud before you invite them. Because it takes the dynamic out, and for negotiators who have to do a lot of field work and groundwork in the days before ministers arrive, how can they risk anything if the head of state is arriving next week? And I mean, I know from some of the delegations in Copenhagen, among some of the big ones, that created a lot of conflict internally. How should they sort of dare to move just a bit outside what was given already? And that created a difficult dynamic. Now this year, it will be different because in Copenhagen, where US and China, again, a bit black-white, but sort of could agree among themselves behind the scenes, we are not moving. Now it's different because they have at least agreed to do something. And that is a very, very important change.
Right in the back. In the corner, yeah.
Thanks. Thanks, Connie. My name's Hannah and I'm part of a community movement called Reclaim the Power. And actually we're holding a event in 2 weekends' time, very close to here, near Didcot gas-fired power station. Everyone in this room is invited. We're working in 2 weeks' time because, as you rightly pointed out, the negotiations are happening now, and to do something in Paris in December is too late. I wanted to pick up on the sort of challenge that you set the scientific and academic community, and hopefully explore more transparently one of the key issues that I see within this challenge. Because there's another community that are working just as hard as the science community are, just as hard as the IPCC are on these talks, and that's the fossil fuel industry. And they're working in a very different way. They're lobbying, blocking, and rerouting the climate negotiations for us. And I think it's problematic to talk about these negotiations in terms of nation states sometimes. You know, this country says this and this country says the other. Because, of course, the fossil fuel industry are global. And so BP, for example, isn't just representing Britain's profits or Britain's interests in this, but it's a global company also working in Saudi Arabia, also working in Africa, et cetera, et cetera. So one example on a micro level,
Can you pose a question, because there are a lot of questions to come in still.
Sure, I thought I'd just, you mentioned the divestment issue, and I can just update you with breaking news, which is quite exciting, I guess. So after a year of students asking for Oxford University to take their investments out of the fossil fuel industry, a statement was released just about 50 minutes ago, I saw on my phone, and the university have said that they will not invest in companies with over 10% production in coal and tar sands. So those two areas explicitly. But it does, of course, mean that they can still invest in Shell, which had most of their production is in oil. And one of the key things
and
there
the question is...
And the question is, where there's a relationship between science and industry, for example, here at Oxford University, Shell works with the Earth Sciences Department and, in fact, sponsored the building. That lobby is huge, and how is that impacting not just in our universities, but also in the COP, in the climate talks, and the decisions that countries can make with such a strong financial global industry lobby?
Is that for me or to you?
That's for you.
It's of course a very central question, and it's, you know, I could give a very lengthy thing. I just think that this divesting, it is interesting. When the biggest bank in the Nordic countries, Nordea, back in February announced they are going out of coal investments. It is interesting when, in the last few weeks, three big pension funds in Denmark, after having the debate, three voted in favor of divesting. Three voted in favor of not changing anything. But this debate, I think at the political level, is interesting. And I think that this stranded assets discussion is interesting, and it must also, in the more progressive of the fossil fuels business, it must be a sort of push forward for those who internally in these companies will argue in favor of diversification. Then I would just say, I think we also have to differentiate a bit among the fossil fuels companies. I mean, we will have fossil fuel in this world for quite a substantial future. And there are some who are really trying to avoid to do the worst things, who are changing now due to the low oil price also, their Arctic drilling and deep water drilling and things like that, plans. I mean, there are many strategies to try to say, okay, we understand you cannot change your total business overnight, but maybe this, as you mentioned, the tar sands, things like that, there are things that are worse than other things. So I think to nuance that, we also need to help those legitimate industries to sort of find ways to do things differently. That's of course also why I think that this price externalities, that could be one, a carbon price would help them at least to make some of the right choices.
Okay, let's have a show of hands, and then I'll try and get as many of you in as possible. The woman in the back in the middle, the gentleman, and I'll work the way forward.
I have a question on the related note of having different stakeholders. Based on your COP15 experience, what kind of role do you think NGOs should have in the forthcoming negotiations, if any? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Man in front there.
Hi there. I just wanted to know, the one thing that I don't ever seem to see any information about is what 3, 4, 5 degrees warming means. And I wonder if that plays any part in any of the talks at the start. And the other quick thing is that I hope if the right agreement doesn't happen in Paris, I'd like to see a new conference for the willing. And is there any possibility of effectively not economically trading with those who do not commit to 2 degrees warming, so there's no economic advantage not to act.
Just to get it right, so not to trade with those who are not willing, was that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Hi, it's kind of on the NGO subject and civil society. I was wondering how it looked from the inside and also how you think civil society and NGOs could actually help the process.
Okay, woman over here, and then I think we'll try and get a second round in after that.
Hi, you've talked a lot about international and interdisciplinary transparency, and as this isn't a short-term issue, do you think it's plausible and worthwhile to try and implement a kind of international curriculum on how this is taught in schools?
Oh, the last one, I'm not the right one to ask that question. I cannot give you a qualified answer whether that is meaningful, say, with the Chinese tradition and the American tradition and Korean tradition and whatever tradition. That would be something for the academic community to try to find out whether that would make sense, or whether the differences or the levels from where you come will be too different. On the NGOs, there were two questions on that. I think that the NGOs play an absolutely essential role. And I think that the good NGOs, what will I call the good NGOs, the constructive NGOs who understand politics, they are playing an extremely constructive role. And with that, I mean those who are just asking for the moon, you know, just to show that I'm just 10 times as progressive as anybody around, you know, that is too easy for politicians to ignore and say, yeah, but that doesn't link to where we are. But the good NGOs, and there are many, they are absolutely essential in providing and translating knowledge, you could say, to keep the pressure, but of course also to be out there mobilizing people. And if one of our big challenges are how to make politicians, ministers, governments dare to think for the longer term when we are living in a policy environment that is so much written by short-termism, the only way that they would really do that is, of course, if there are some citizens out there demanding that from them. Now, you know yourself, you've just been through an election campaign, I understand. how much were these topics part of that? But I mean, that kind of pressure, that is absolutely essential that the NGOs will help create a paving the way in that sense. To the question whether what does 3, 4, 5 degrees means, yeah, the knowledge is there, I think. But again, it's one of the areas, you know, where as a scientist, you would not imagine how many times you would have to convey the same piece of information before it gets to just 0.1% of those who need to know it. And I know that this is sort of just boring and what can you do? You're doing your research. But communication to others than your own peers, that is extremely important if politicians are going to get this right, also with these alternative possible scenarios. And what will happen if Paris is not, well, yeah. My own take will be, say that Paris is not delivering a decent outcome. I believe that Paris will for many reasons, but say it didn't. Then I think that what we will be seeing is a radicalization of some countries, vulnerable countries, some of the NGO community definitely losing patience with the politicians. So I think that this attempt that we have been trying to sort of have for 5 to 10 years, and that is also sort of the project here at Oxford Martin School, to get the climate issues and the low carbon thinking into the core of the economy, there I would fear we would see polarization. And some would be very much radicalized, and others would just say, wow, nothing happened, we can just continue business as usual. I think it would be very, very challenging. And I do not think that then the day after we will see a coalition of the willing. Just sort of, there would be some who would feel that they are forced to deliver something because of this process, but if that process was not there, yeah, China and India would, China and the US would talk, but then it would basically be that. Where would the pressure come from? I cannot see it. And you would have a lot of developing countries being very, very sort of angry and mobilized in a way that would not sort of bring things forward, I think. So I really think if Paris totally failed, then I think we have a whole problem with the UNFCCC process. I know that some people start to say now, oh, Paris is coming up very shortly. Wow, everybody said they were ready prior to Copenhagen. Then in Durban, we set the deadline 4 years before Paris. I mean, there are many excuses, but we should not say we are not ready to sort of play ball now. And if that would end so in Paris, I think don't underestimate what kind of frustration that would be released there, and we would see polarization. Okay. But you know, as I told you, Ian, we will have a success somehow in Paris, because as Fabius said at some point, the French foreign minister, he said, I have understood that this is a very important conference. It's about the future of the planet. And then he added, and even worse, the reputation of French diplomacy. So I'm sure they will do their best.
All right, we have about 6 minutes left. We have lots of hands. Be very, very pointed in your questions. The two gentlemen here, we'll work back.
I'm Andrew Mitchell from the Global Canopy Programme here in Oxford. I spent a long time in many of the COPs with negotiators dealing with the issue, actually, with forests. But the issue here seems to me you've got two key things that are ranged against you. First of all is lack of interest in public opinion. In the last election in this country, I hardly ever heard the word climate change or environment. And secondly, that there is a tsunami of money that is flowing around the world that is running counter to the kinds of things we talk about in the COPs. And the problem can be resolved if we look for acupuncture points like bank regulators to change the way in which they allow price signals to occur in the market. And it seems to. So my question to you is, to what extent can the negotiators start to look for these kinds of acupuncture points which will solve the problem you posed, is how do I get this out of an environment ministry and into an economics ministry?
Person next to you.
I have a simpler question. I'm Jeff Burnham from Georgetown University. Do you expect, and do you have any suggestions as to whether the media could play a constructive role in the lead up to Paris? I mean, the media is famous for raising expectations beyond the ability of politicians to fulfill. They also like conflict, black and white, etc. Do you have any reasonable expectations or suggestions as to how the media might be more responsible in the next 6 months?
I have a question come through from Twitter. Just about, it's difficult to assess how much public demand there is for a global agreement. So if agreement is reached and there isn't an acknowledged public demand for that, does this risk alienating people from their governments, i.e. would there be a democratic deficit?
Okay, and gentleman over there with, final question, I'm afraid we've got time for.
You talked very vividly about the difficulty of conducting these negotiations in front of 40,000 people, and explained that states would be hardening their own positions around September. What work is going on between now and December at a supranational level to formulate model agreements, proposals, and who is leading on that?
I would say a lot of work is going on. Right now, I happen to know that the usual 40 or 50 ministers will be gathered in Berlin for the Petersberg dialogue. You will have major economies forum. You will have the regional ministers meeting, discussing. You will have in June the bond negotiations where negotiators will meet. Between all these more or less formal things, you will have informal groups, for instance, sitting down, discussing for days sometimes, also at the ministerial level, how can we provide more investment, more alternative financing things here? How can we include other players? So on and so forth. A whole plethora of really between the COPs negotiations. So that's also when we are saying What about these cops? Don't underestimate how much work is being done. This gentleman was mentioning forestry. I mean, the LULUCF rules, the Red Plus, all this, it takes a tremendous amount of work. And that's also why some of us said, just to reject what we already have and create something quite new, sometimes you get the feeling they are not really knowing what we would lose there, because although it looks as it looks, many, many things have been solved over the years in between the COPs and at the COPs. So a lot of things are going on there. On this question on bank regulators and things like that, I would just say that is the kind of things that, one, I would not leave it to climate negotiators, and two, they would not pay attention to that. I mean, you have been into these, so you know sort of the span of what is there. So this is more for, you know, when EU is doing regulation on the financial sectors, not to make it impossible to invest in renewables and still have sort of live up to the Basel II regulation or Basel III or whatever regulation. It's there. You need the international financial institutions and you need the finance ministers, because this is not something that would ever come into the core of the UNFCCC, and also the secretariat and others, it's not the kind of specialist that they really need that would deal with these kind of things. So that is why we need others. Can media play a constructive role? Yes. Are they playing a constructive role? Sometimes, sometimes not. But I have to say one thing. I could talk at length, and we don't have time for that now, about what media is doing and what they're not doing. But there, I also have one experience I would share with you from my time as an EU commissioner. When sometimes expectations are raised, you know, beyond, as you were mentioning, what has any chance of being adopted? That is not just because of media. It's also because there will always be this minister or that minister or that minister who would like to show that they are, of course, more progressive than the others. Just to give you one example, at the first meeting, end of October, after we had adopted the 2030 targets in the European Union, at least 40% domestic reduction, at the first meeting for 13 green ministers in the Green Growth Group, special group for green ministers, several ministers said, now we should try and go out and say we would go for 50% in Paris. I mean, go for 50%? Good luck to get Poland on board there. It's not going to happen. Where I sometimes think that it's also about having a strategy and be careful that we are not, because this one or that one wants to be seen as progressive to the domestic audience, are creating expectations that in the end can only disappoint people. So there is also a dynamic there with the politicians, that if they're getting really serious up to Paris, that they also have to have some self-discipline. And then just finally on the democratic deficit, what if there is no demand for a deal? I would not be afraid of that, because I really think it's not sort of a general cry out there with all people, as was mentioned about your election campaign. But if you really ask the citizens of Europe, more and more in the United States, in China, you can frame the question in many ways, but I think there is quite a wish that now the politicians must get their act together. Not by 100%, not by 50%, there never is on anything 50%, but there is a general call and expectation out there. What we just need is to have that a bit more into the open, so that it gets more difficult for politicians to be dragging their feet too long, meaning that we risk not getting the outcome that we could have gotten from Paris if all good forces worked together. But we will get an agreement. It's up to civil society to take care. That it's not something that just looks nice, but something that actually helps to close the gap towards the 2 degrees in order to stop that moving. Thank you very much.
Connie. that was absolutely tremendous, not only presentation, but response to a very wide range of questions. I'm deeply sorry that you're no longer in the driving seat, because I would feel a lot more optimistic about the outcome. But knowing that you're still engaged and knowing that you're passing on your wisdom to those that are now in the driving seat is immensely encouraging, as it is to all of us, to gain your insights. Fortunately, this is not the end of the conversation in the Oxford Martin School on these issues. There's a very wide-ranging research program here, which many in the room are associated with, which is reflected on our website. And we also have been running a series of seminars every Thursday for the last 10 weeks during terms, and we have got two more to go on that. So this Thursday, we have one on sustainable transport, electric dreams versus carbon reality, and on the 28th of May, Cameron Hepburn on green economic growth. We also have many other events going on, as always. On the 27th of May, we have Chris Woods, who's an extraordinary journalist working on the drones, talking about that. And on the 3rd of June, Joe Nye, who is the former director of the Kennedy School at Harvard University, is talking about the China-US relationship at 7:30. All of that on our website. We look forward to continuing to be engaged with Connie on the outcome of the Oxford Martin Commission for Future Generations, which is also on our website, and engaging with you on many of these other issues. Connie, thank you for coming, and thanks to all of you for being here.